We have been looking at what happens when you have when you use an op-amp which has poles inside it, and you use that op-amp to build a negative feedback amplifier. What we saw was when the op-amp has only one pole, then the response is very well behaved. You get a first order response for the amplifier as well, and the bandwidth of the amplifier is the same as the unity loop gain frequency. Okay, and that makes intuitive sense, because where the loop gain is very high, you get ideal behavior, and where the as the loop gain drops off below 1, it becomes quite non-ideal. Okay. Now, when you had a second order op-amp, that is op-amp with two poles inside it, then the closed loop response, the closed loop gain also had two poles. And as with any second order response, you could have different types of behavior, a very sluggish one, which is called overdamped, or you could have the quickest one without overshooting, which is called critically damped. And also you could have overshooting and a lot of ringing, that is the natural response will overshoot beyond the target of zero, or if you apply a step, it goes beyond the steady state value and back and forth many times before settling down. Typically, if in absence of any other information, you would design a system to be critically damped or maybe slightly underdamped so that it reaches the steady state quickly. Okay, so that means that the damping factor value should be maybe between 0.5 and 1 or something like that. You would never want a damping factor value of, let's say, 0.01. You also typically don't want to overdamp the system and make it very slow. Okay, so I would say if you didn't have any other specific criterion given to you, then damping factors between 0.5 and 1 would be okay. 0.5 would be slightly underdamped and 1 would be critically damped. So what did we see? We saw that the expression for the damping factor, what was it in the second order case? 0.5 square root, what was it? K by A naught square root P1 by P2 plus square root P2 by P1. So to get reasonable damping factors, and A naught by K is the DC loop gain, so A naught by K will be very large, or this term under the square root will be very small. So the poles are similar to each other, it is serious bad news. You can see that, in fact, this expression, it is minimum when the two poles are on top of each other, right? So that's when you get the minimum damping factor, and the minimum damping factor is likely to be very small because A0 by K will be very large. Okay, so the only way to make this have a reasonable damping factor is to make one of the poles much more than the other, and in fact the ratio of the poles should be nearly the same as the DC loop gain. Okay, so in that case you will get a healthy damping factor. And in fact, for zeta equals 1, what do you want P2 by P1 to be? 4 times A0 by K. And for zeta equals 0.5, what will it be? It will just be A0 by K. And for zeta equals 1 over square root 2, P2 by P1 is 2 times A0 by K. Okay. So instead of writing it like this, let me take P1 to the other side. That makes it even clearer what is happening. And what is this number? A0 by K times P1 in a first order system. In a first order system, you have some pole P1. What's that number, A0 by K times P1? What's that? Unity loop gain frequency. It's the frequency at which the loop gain becomes unity. So you can think of now having a first order system. It is of course well behaved, and it has a unity gain frequency at A0 by K times P1. Now you can say, you can ask yourself the question, where can you introduce the second pole without affecting it too much? And obviously the answer is where?
beyond, yeah,
certainly it shouldn't be within the unity loop gain frequency. That is, basically after the loop gain starts going below 0 dB, essentially there is no negative feedback at that point. You can have the pole and there will be no problem, okay? So, one of the ways of thinking about it is to say that, hey, for all practical purposes, you made the second order system look like a first order system. That is, as far as the loop gain is concerned, and then things will be okay, right? So, that's one way of getting well-behaved responses from higher order systems. The exact value of zeta that you choose depends very much on the application. It will be in this range, but it could be that zeta is less, slightly less than half. That may also be okay. In some cases, maybe you will be able to tolerate a little ringing. Okay, it's not likely that you will have a system where zeta is 0.1 or 0.01 or something, but somewhere in this range is fine. So the magnitude of the, no, I mean, there is some advantage to, what is the significance of zeta equals 1 over square root 2, do you know? Zeta equals 1, it's the fastest response without overshooting. But the zeta equals 1 over square root 2 also has some significance. What is that? Fastest with underdamping, is it? With underdamping, yeah. Zeta equals 1 over square root 2 is underdamped. Settles to what accuracy? I don't think it's 90%, but anyway, that exactly, if you, that's not it. In that, for instance, let's say you have highly overdamped, highly underdamped system, and your accuracy is 50%, that is, you want to reach here. Obviously, this is the fastest, right? So this is not it. It's actually, it's in the, it has to do with the frequency domain response. So let's say the transfer function is 1 by 1 plus a square by omega n square plus 2 zeta s by omega n. This is in the standard form, right? Okay. So now, what do you think happens if you, yeah, please do this actually. Plot, essentially I want a plot, but not a Bode approximation. Okay, Bode approximation simply says that at low frequencies it's 1, and at very high frequencies it will fall off at minus 40 dB per decade. In fact, I want to know what's happening in the middle. Okay, how would you do this? Okay. One by root 2, the peak will be highest. Please evaluate. I mean, first just write down the expression for this, and I want the expression in the form. This will be a function of omega, right? Maybe you can do it for mod square. It doesn't matter. Okay. So I want it also as a polynomial in omega square. I mean, it will have omega to the 4, obviously, then omega square and so on. I want the denominator to be written as a polynomial in omega with the coefficient, then you will see. Okay, let's see. First of all, give me the expression. What do I get here? If I substitute s equals j omega, what is the highest power in let's say I take square, or even if I take mod, I'll get square root of that. That's all. Okay. So what's the highest power of omega I get? 4th, and it will be normalized to omega n anyway. Okay. What's the coefficient? Sorry, 4. The 4th power. What's the coefficient? 1. Okay. What's the next term that you get? Lower one. Square. It will be, first of all, the magnitude will always be, will always contain only even powers of omega, okay? Have you seen this result before? Why does it contain only even powers of omega? Where have you seen it? Have you ever done like Fourier transforms and so on in signals and systems? Okay. Does it have anything to do with this? What can you say about the Fourier transform of a real signal? Huh? Conjugate symmetry, yeah, okay. What does it mean for the magnitude? Magnitude is even. That's all. That's what this is saying, right? What is this after all? What is, I know, how is this related to Fourier transform of anything? S equals 0? Yeah. Fourier transform of what? Of? Fourier transform of the transfer function. I usually don't do that. So impulse response. The impulse response of a real system is real, and then it's the Fourier transform of that. Yeah, something related. What's the coefficient of this? Omega by omega n squared. What's that? 4? 2. Okay. And then? 1. Okay. At very low frequencies. Low meaning, what does low mean here? Omega much less than omega n, the natural frequency of the system. So what is the magnitude going to be? 1, obviously. This is the term that will dominate at low frequencies. Okay? And what happens at very high frequencies? Again, meaning omega much more than omega n. Which is the term that will dominate? Obviously this one. But it doesn't matter how this is. I mean, it's the fourth power after all. It will soon overtake both of these, and then that's the only thing that matters. Okay, so the damping factor mainly affects the transition from here to there. And what happens now? If zeta is very large, what will happen? Huh? Clearly, all these terms become positive, right? And this is in the denominator. So, at low frequencies, it was 1. And after that, you have some positive coefficient times omega by omega n square. So, that means that the denominator increases. Okay? So, this will start dropping, and then finally it will kind of merge with that part, okay? And if zeta is very small, what happens? Obviously, right? Because zeta is very small means this 4 zeta square minus 2 will be negative, okay? So you start with the denominator being 1, and actually it becomes smaller than 1. So the magnitude goes above 1, okay? And then it will have some peak. What's the value of the peak? Where will the peak be? Roughly. You have to differentiate and do that. But just take a wild guess about where the peak will be. Omega n. So it's not exactly at omega n, but tell me what's the value at omega n? Huh? 1 by 2 zeta, right? Because obviously at omega n, this will cancel that, isn't it? S equals j omega, that will cancel that. So, the gain will be, actually it will be 1 by 2 zeta, and it turns out the actual peak will be slightly after omega n, I think, if I remember right. So, and it will come down, okay? So, what happens at zeta equals 1 over square root 2? There won't be a peak, so basically this term goes away, okay? So, the denominator will have 1 plus omega by omega n to the 4, and it will remain flat, okay? And then later it will start falling, okay? So what can you say about this? To what? That is okay. In terms of some useful parameters of the system. I mean, just like we said, the critically damped is the fastest one without overshooting. What can you say about this? Yeah. It's not the highest, actually. Obviously, it is higher for smaller zeta, but it's the one that gives the highest bandwidth, but without peaking in the frequency response. Okay? So, zeta equals 1 over square root 2. So, these are two different things. Zeta equals half gives you the critically damped response that is related to the time domain. So, it will give you the fastest step response without overshooting in the step response. Whereas, zeta equals 1 over square root 2, that gives you the widest bandwidth. This is got bandwidth is related to the frequency domain performance, right? As you apply a sinusoid, it will give you some response as the frequency of the sinusoid is varied. This gives you the widest bandwidth without having a peak. Okay, so that is of some interest also. Okay, to have the biggest bandwidth that is possible. So that's why, I mean, you may want to have zeta slightly less than 1, because that gives you better bandwidth, right? This is okay. So all these are, I mean, finally eventually come from some practical considerations. I mean, highly overdamped is very bad because now you have like smaller bandwidth. Okay. What happens if zeta equals 0? Huh? What's that? Yeah, it will go to infinity. What is that? If zeta equals 0, what does it mean? So that's what it will look like. On a log plot, I cannot show that, but or in any plot, I can't show infinity. But what is that? No damping. It's basically a resonant circuit. So that means that if you do that, what will happen? What do you expect to see from the circuit? Huh? Saturation? No. What do you see from it? Huh? It will? What will blow up? I mean, it will explode, or what do you mean by blow up? What will I see? I mean, I build a circuit and somehow the zeta turns out to be 0. What would I observe? It will oscillate. Actually, if I do it with an op-amp, what will happen is it will start oscillating and probably hit the saturation rails. So, it will give you a sustained oscillation. Okay. So, it will give you a sinusoid at that frequency. Okay. And the zeta being small but not 0, it's a tendency to oscillate, right? This you can see, I mean, this peak, that means that a small input there will give you an output there. So the circuit has a natural tendency to oscillate at that frequency. Now if you have damping, that means that eventually those oscillations will die out. If you don't have damping, if zeta equals 0, it will sustain forever. Okay. So the zeta equals 1 over square root 2. This is known as the maximally flat magnitude response. So that means that, I mean, ideally what would you have wanted? You would have wanted the, in an amplifier, the gain to be constant at all frequencies. Okay. Now if you have any frequency dependence, if you have poles, this is not going to happen, because eventually the gain will fall off below that value and go up to zero at high frequencies. This maximally flat means that it is as flat as possible. I mean, that's what whatever it says in plain English. Now, if we evaluate it mathematically, it turns out that the maximum number of the derivatives at omega equal to 0 are 0. Okay? So, if every derivative is 0, you will get a flat line, right? That's not the case, but given the order of the system, the maximum number of derivatives that are possible to be made 0 will be 0. Okay? If you have a higher order system, you can have also maximal flatness for that. Okay? And you will get a similar response. But at least for the second order stuff, you should understand and remember the results. Okay? So just like you have underdamped, overdamped, and critically damped with terms that refer to the time domain step response, you have maximally flat and a peaky response and a low bandwidth overdamped response when you talk about frequency responses. Okay. The step response of the maximally flat magnitude case will look like this. So it will slightly overshoot and then settle down. Okay. Because the damping factor is only slightly less than 1. Any questions about any of this? So this was just to say, answer the question, why would you ever want an overdamped response? Because you have higher bandwidth, because, why would you want an underdamped response? Okay, because critical damped is very nice, but it comes at a cost. Okay, we'll see. The bandwidth will be smaller. Yeah. Okay, so I have assumed that wherever it goes to 1 over square root 2, that's the bandwidth. So we have to define the bandwidth in whatever way we want. I mean, it could be 3 dB bandwidth is the most common definition. But, by the way, for the maximally flat case, what will be the 3 dB bandwidth? Let's look at the expression. omega n. Obviously, the middle term is not there. When omega equals omega n, it becomes 1 over square root 2. Bandwidth equals omega n. So, typically, we take the 3 dB bandwidth, but you could specify the 1 dB bandwidth thickness. Okay. It's basically our definition. Any questions about any of these things? Okay, so what was I saying? We have the loop gain, which has a DC value of A0 by K, a pole at P1, it goes that way, and another pole at P2. This is how it should look like for a well-behaved system. Okay, where this is A0 by K times P1, and this is a factor of 4. This is for critical damping. Okay. And the phase of the, okay, phase, let me not draw it now. The closed loop response, you have to make some approximation. One approximation that we can frequently use is, of course, the gain is close to K. It is actually K by 1 plus K by A0. And it remains that, as far as the Bode approximation is concerned, up to the unity loop gain frequency. After that, what will it do? In this, I mean, this depends on the particular op-amp. What happens? What will be the approximation beyond the unity loop gain frequency? By the way, let me also draw the gain of the op-amp by itself. That will have a DC value of A0. It's simply the loop gain shifted up by factor K, right? So what happens to the closed loop gain beyond the unity loop gain frequency? That day we discussed it, right? I mean, in case of the first order, what did we say? Huh? It will be basically, yeah, it is like, we apply VI here, there is no feedback coming here, roughly speaking. Okay? So it will simply, it's like applying VI to the op-amp itself. Okay? So it will just follow the open loop characteristic. Okay, and the bandwidth, this is usually an acceptable approximation. The expression for the bandwidth you have to calculate from the second order response, right? You have to calculate the magnitude of the denominator and see where it goes to square root of 2 times the DC value. But roughly speaking, you can do this. Okay, and I've already given the intuitive reason for this many times, that the negative feedback system behaves in an ideal way up to the unity loop gain frequency and non-ideally beyond that. Any questions about this? So, to summarize, the second order case is with the second order op-amp also we have unconditional stability. That itself is not a problem. That is, if you have only two poles and you have negative feedback, it's not going to go into oscillation, but it can look very bad in that it can also, it can ring many times before it settles to the steady state value. Okay, so that is a problem. Okay, because it's not good. Okay, you can't say that, hey, this eventually settles. This is a very bad response. It takes a long time. You don't want this. Many reasons you don't want this. I mean, I think the mechanical analogies, it's very clear. If you're driving, you don't want the ride to be like this. You go over a bump and then it goes up and down so many times. But even in electrical circuits, like one of the places where you use negative feedback systems is the power supply, for instance. It gives you a very precisely regulated supply, and such precise regulation is possible only by negative feedback. It senses the output voltage and makes sure that it is some value. But imagine, what is the step response? Maybe when you turn on the supply, it does this. What could happen? Do you see any risk here or no? This is the desired supply voltage, okay? And your circuit gets applied something that is much more than that. It could actually damage the circuit, for instance, if it overshoots, right? So, in this case, clearly, And this is a very common case, right? I mean, you have the supply connected to the circuit and then you turn on the supply. It's very common, I think. So you would want it to go that way, right? You don't want to exceed the ratings of the. So there are many other cases where you don't want overshoots. Even if you are not concerned with the time, okay? So here you may not be concerned with how long it takes for it to reach steady state. Even then, you don't want overshoots for sure, because that can be very bad. And also, similarly, if you look at modern digital systems like a microprocessor, it's very sophisticated. I mean, in that, there are different parts of the processor or any digital IC which operate at different supply voltages. The reason is the power dissipation of a digital circuit. Have you seen this? What is the? Do you know what the power dissipation of a gate is? Huh? Logic gate. Have you done this in digital circuit? No? Yes or no? No is the easy answer because I can't go back and check, but if you do remember it, let me know what it is. So it turns out it is related to, capacitance? Yeah, something related to that. Basically, it is CV square F. Okay. So what happens when you, how come only three of you attended classes? Right? I mean, so, what happens with a logic gate is, there will be a small capacitor at the output of the logic gate. Every time it switches to 1, that capacitor gets charged to VDD. And every time the output of the logic gate goes to 0, it gets discharged to ground. So essentially, as long as you are switching, it is constantly getting charged and that charge is getting dumped. So that's where the power dissipation comes in. It's not in the capacitor, of course. It's in the switches that charge the capacitor. And if you calculate it, it will turn out that it's basically for every transition, every time you charge it to 1 and discharge it to 0, how much energy do you lose? CV square. So the I guess what is the energy required to charge the capacitor to voltage V? Half CV square? Loss. Loss in the battery, no. Loss in the resistor. I have an ideal switch, so that means that when I close it, it will get shorted. Okay? So, and I have a voltage V0. This is initially charged to 0. Okay? So, I close this. How much energy is taken from the battery? CV square. Why? Where does the energy go? This is getting an energy of half CV0 square, right? So impulse current, so what happened? It is true, actually. I mean, if you have a resistance here and calculate, you will find that the energy dissipated in this is half CV0 square. And this is independent of the resistance value. As you send the resistance to 0, one interpretation, the circuit interpretation is to say that, hey, you have an impulse current that is an infinitely large current spike through a zero resistance, and that still gives you non-zero energy dissipation. But in reality, what happens is you can't have impulses and there will be radiation losses in the loop if you actually try to make it, okay, with a zero resistance loop. So anyway, every time you charge a capacitor, you supply, you draw an energy of CV square and you dump it into ground, right? And if you do this at a rate F, you get CV square times F as the power dissipation. Okay? So now you can see the dependence on the supply voltage is very strong. Okay? It's V square. So if you want to operate things at low power, which is always a concern because you want the battery to last as long as possible, you would like to lower the supply voltage to a smaller value. Now, of course, as it so happens that if you make the supply voltage small, the circuits also operate more slowly. Okay, so you can't go on reducing the supply voltage either, right? So now it turns out that in a complex digital IC, different parts will be operating at different voltages and different frequencies. Not everything needs to operate at the 2.4 gigahertz I7, whatever you see as the spec, right? There are many parts which are operating much more slowly and are operating at a smaller voltage. Or sometimes, I mean, maybe the load on the processor is smaller, so the whole thing can run at a lower rate. So there is a very complex dynamic voltage and frequency management in the processor. So what happens is maybe the supply voltage will keep doing this, okay? It will keep changing.
Here also you can see when you reduce it, if you go below a certain value, then the digital circuit cannot function at all. So then you may have a problem. Okay. So anyway, that's just to motivate you to say that you should not, you generally don't want like large overshoots either way, okay, while going up or going down. Here actually it may not damage the circuit, but it may disable it in some way. So fine, I think we have done very thorough, maybe more thorough than necessary analysis of the second order case. So we can move on to higher order stuff. What do you think will happen if I have 3 poles, 4 poles, I mean besides more and more painful analysis? So let's first try the third order case. And the one is, of course, I think you already deduced that there will be instability because of the tutorial problem. But the more important thing is to figure out how to make it stable, right? I mean, you can't say, hey, I can't solve it. You can't stop it. Try to fix the problem. So let's go through this quickly. And I'll continue to take the non-inverting amplifier. You can do the same, exact same exercises with the inverting amplifier. Assume a one pole op amp, two pole op amp, and so on. It will give you good insight into what happens. And also, kind of comparing the two results, you can figure out what is general across all circuits. I mean, we're extending from two to all circuits, but still, that's okay. And what results are specific only to the non-inverting amplifier or the inverting amplifier. Okay? Now, we'll have three poles. And in general, the three poles can be anywhere. But then the expressions become annoyingly complicated. So, I'll assume that the op-amp has three identical poles. Okay. So what will be V0 by VI? And we have done this so many times, right? What is it? What's that? K by 1 plus K by A of S, which is this whole thing. So we K by A naught. 1 plus S by P1 cube. Okay. Now, how do you gauge if there is instability? Of course, you can try to find the poles, pole locations, and see if they are in the right half plane or the left half plane. That is possible, but that needs like more algebra. Okay. I forget, are you doing control engineering now or next semester? Okay. So, I think there are many techniques to do this, but you would not be familiar with that, so let's not go there. Now, one of the, I mean, maybe in many cases, an easier way is to at least look for when the poles are on the imaginary axis. Okay? So, why is that easier? What will you calculate in that case? No, that's okay, but it has to somehow make your calculation easier. So, H of S has some zeros and some poles, okay? Each of these can be complex also. Now, what does it mean to say that for S equals J omega, that is for some, what does it mean to say that the system has poles on the imaginary axis? Oh, no, that's okay, but you keep oscillating, so that means what can you, for some S equals J omega, what do you expect? I mean, what does it mean to say it keeps oscillating? It keeps oscillating without an input. So, what do you say from there? I mean, without an input, it's giving you an output. So, what does it mean? Gain? What's the value of the gain? Infinity. So, it has infinite gain for some frequency omega. Okay, we don't know what it is, but it has for the H of J omega equals infinity for some omega. If H of S has poles on the J omega axis. Okay? Is this clear? I mean, I'm not saying anything special here. What is a pole? A pole is where the denominator polynomial goes to 0 or H of S goes to infinity. Now, I'm just saying that this will happen for some sinusoidal frequency. So, in that case, you will have sustained sinusoidal oscillation. Okay? So, essentially, we look for the denominator being 0 for some s equals j omega. Okay. How did you solve the problem? What was the condition given? Or you are simply asked to make the denominator 0 and find the condition in the tutorial? Yeah, you plotted the, okay. So how did you find the poles? I know, but I mean, do you know how to solve the third order polynomial roots? Or? Yeah, in this case it's easy because there are three identical poles. Okay. So I mean, essentially what I'm saying boils down to the same thing. So you can also do this, right? You can just find out and the calculation will be exactly the same. So in this particular case, the denominator has a particularly simple form. So k by a naught, 1 plus s pi, p1 cube. If this is equal to 0, so that means that 1 plus s pi p1 cube is minus k by a naught. Okay. And 1 plus s pi p1 is cube root of this, and you have to consider all three complex cube roots of this. Huh? So all three complex cube roots of this number. Okay, so this can be written as a naught by k exponential minus j pi. Okay, and what are the three cube roots? What are the three values? One is not a cube root of minus one. Yeah. So it's minus 1 and then exponential minus j 4 pi by 3 and then exponential j pi by 3, right? Are these correct? This is not correct. What's that? It was 2 pi by 3. No, that's when you get, when you cube it, you will get 2 pi, right? Minus a pi by 3. Okay. So when you cube this, you should get that. Anyway, actually, I made a silly mistake in that. That couldn't have been the case. The two complex roots must be conjugates of each other. Okay, if you find one, you would find the other one. Because the polynomial you started off with has real coefficients, right? So the whatever roots I get, even if I get wrong answer, it's better to give wrong answers with the conjugates of each other. Okay. So fine. Anyway, what do we deduce from this? It will be unstable for some. I mean, we have to find the instability condition. So how do you find that? How did you find the instability condition? So this is, what is this for instance? It is half plus j square root 3 by 2. Okay. And this is equal to what? So I mean times cube root of a naught by k, and this is equal to 1 plus j omega by p1. Okay, so by equating the real and imaginary parts, you find that if a naught by k equals 8, you will have poles at, what is the value of the pole? Square root 3 p1, right? So that means that if you have a loop gain of 8, this will oscillate at a frequency which is square root 3 times p1. Okay, so clearly this is becoming unstable, and not only that, it's becoming unstable at a very small value of a naught by k, and you want to make a naught by k very large in a negative feedback system. Okay, so how do we fix this? We'll get into the details in the next class, but let's say based on what we know about the second order case, what do you think we need to do? Which one? That has got nothing to do with it. I mean, once the system is unstable, it doesn't matter where that where it will oscillate, right? Because once you start the circuit, it will start oscillating at that frequency. Okay, once the circuit is oscillating, it's useless. It doesn't matter where it oscillates. Maybe it's oscillating at 1 MHz and you want to apply only like 1 Hz signals. It is still a useless circuit. Okay, because what will happen when it oscillates is, I mean, this is after all a circuit with an op amp. A purely linear circuit, it will keep oscillating with the sinusoid forever. In this case, not only that, it will go and clip at the saturation values of the op amp and so on. Okay. So, the location of the frequency of oscillation, if it is unstable, is not relevant. Once it is unstable, you can't use it. What do you have to do? What did we do in the second order case to fix the ringing problem? Poles should be widely separated. I think we will find that that's exactly what we have to do here also. And you can kind of see. So, in this case, we took three poles which were on top of each other. Okay. And in the second order case also, of course, it was not outright unstable, but we see that the damping factor is smallest when the poles are on top of each other, right? So, somehow having identical poles is the worst thing for stability, okay? So, we will see why. We will give some plausibility arguments. We are not done control engineering, so some of the tools won't be accessible to us, but I think we can still get enough intuition from what you know about Laplace transforms and so on. So, it turns out that having poles on top of each other is the absolute worst thing to have as far as stability is concerned. So, you have to move them far apart, okay, and that's what we will do for the third order case as well, or any higher order case.